When you go with pulsed DC heating, you go deal with a process called spark plasma sintering. In this case, you fill the powder into a die just like before, and the die is graphite, so it's conducting die, electrically conducting die. And you have a top punch and a bottom punch. Now the punches are connected through a pulse DC. And so what happens is, now you are resistively heating applying this volt, the pulsed heating going back and forth, you begin to generate heat, Joule effect. So when you begin to generate enough heat, you can now sinter the powder. The main advantage is you can get very high heating rates. Okay, so your throughput is faster. The other thing is, we said as density increases with temperature, earlier we had said that something else that happens to the material as you raise the temperature or increase the time that a material is present at high temperature. What is that attribute of the material property, of the material structure that changes as you keep something at a high temperature for a long time? Okay, grain growth, very good. So now you can see that if you have very high heating rates, the amount of time that the material spends at an elevated temperature is a lot lower. And so in addition to increasing the throughput, you can limit the grain size. And there are some properties that are better with smaller grain size compared to other properties. Right? Can you give some examples of how grain size affects properties? Correct. And in some cases, that is useful, and some cases it's bad, right? So some examples of what properties improve with decreased grain size. Can you provide some examples? You have some material science classes. When the grain size, so you have very high heating rates, you can make fine grain size structures. So where can you see a benefit of something like that? What properties benefit from small grain sizes? Not all, but some.
Yes,
creep, very good. So creep, so flow of the material at under pressure at high temperatures is compromised by small grain size. But hardness, for instance, will improve. And so that's one motive driving force of trying to use fine-grained zirconia particles, for instance. If you use small enough starting grain size and you can preserve that grain size during sintering, you can get very hard zirconia products. And so that would be one way. You can make very good cutting tools. Right? So that would be one way of looking at that. Right? So main thing is very high heating rates. Yes, some examples. Why? You can tell. Doesn't matter. Transparency, optical properties can change as well. Electrical properties can change. Electrical resistance goes up as grain size decreases. And so you can make a better insulator by reducing the grain size. And of course, magnetic domains need to be larger. So you need to have higher grain sizes in that case. Okay. So some kinds of examples. So main thing is another way of heating under pressure, but the pulsed electrical heating will allow you very high heating rates and you can confine grain size in addition to densifying materials. Okay. The final category of solid state or no additive approach we'll call selective laser sintering. Right? You saw in the previous case electrical energy creating a resistive heating and provides enough heat to fuse the particles together, sinter the particles together. You can use the energy from a laser beam, right, and be able to bond the particles together as well. And again, you scan a laser across, it's a huge dose of concentrated energy. Again, you can have rapid sintering of materials. In the case of selective laser sintering, it takes advantage of the fact that a laser beam can be focused in different regions by moving mirrors. Okay, And so you can focus it on different regions on a surface, right? And so just like in the case of a cutting tool, you can move it around and create a part. If you have a drawing on a computer, a CAD drawing, right, a CAD file, which now guides the motion of the laser across the bed of powder, you can selectively center some regions which are exposed to the laser and leave the rest of the particle uncintered. So in that way, if you take one layer of powder and now you scan a beam across in this manner and you center certain regions, now you add a new layer of powder and you add a second region of sintering and so on, you can build up a three-dimensional part. So that becomes very, so that's what selective laser sintering does. You take a CAD file. Everyone knows what a CAD file is. CAD stands for computer aided design, right? So it is a way to be able to draw a part in three dimensions, right? And so now that part is drawing that is there in the computer is sliced into multiple layers. Each layer has a thickness that is the same as the thickness of the powder bed, right? And so layer by layer you sinter the parts. The areas that are exposed to the laser beam are fused together. The areas that are not exposed to the laser beam are not sintered. And at the end of the process, you just pull out the part and the powder, loose powder falls off and you have a component, okay? So this is what it means. You could have a lot of different lasers, and depending upon the laser source, the energy of the laser will be different, right? You can focus the laser beam to different regions of a powder bed. In this case, what you have is you have a drum of powder and it rolls this over a surface, right? This is the stage. This stage can move up and down, okay? So you have a region, there's a drum that rolls out the powder and keeps it uniform. Now there's a laser beam that comes around, it's focused, right? The computer file shows which path the laser beam will trace. So the path that is exposed to the laser beam will be centered. The other regions will have powder that is just loose in nature. After you finish that layer, this stage will drop by a certain height that is prefixed. And now a new layer of powder is put over that, right? Directed by the slice that you have created on the computer part. And now the laser beam will now trace another layer. And then this drum will fall down by a little bit more. You put more powder, you will trace the laser beam part. And so now, over a period of time, you can build a three-dimensional part. And it can be as complex as that. Yes, yes. So just like you have a two-dimensional photo and you say print to the computer and the printer prints it out on one single sheet of paper, right? Instead of an inkjet printer, you have a laser beam that is tracing out a map of that one layer, and then now it's putting another sheet of paper on and it's now printing the other one, and if you bond all of them together, you can get something like that. And now this is something with all the internal holes that are there, as you can see from the lighting, right? It would be hard to make by compacting in one direction because you have all these things going out in all those different directions. There's no mold that you can take it out of. How far? It depends on a lot of variables. It depends, of course, firstly, how thick is the layer that you're building, right? The thicker the layer, the fewer the number of steps that you might have. But the thicker the layer, the more rough the surface, correct? And of course, if it's too thick, then you might not be able to have the laser beam. You do it in about, you can, depending upon the size of the, it also depends on the size of the part. So you can make something from about several hours to about a day or so. Yeah, something like that, depending upon the part complexity. This part is about something about this big. It's a manifold, gas manifold. And in this case, it was made out of nylon particles that were sintered together, right? Because a polymer is going to sinter at a lower temperature, but you can sinter stainless steel, you can sinter titanium, all from different variations related to that. Okay. So solid state, additives or no additives, creating shapes of all kinds of complexity, throughput, and density. There are trade-offs between that. So you can imagine if you're making one part only one day, you're not going to sell a whole lot of parts, right? So this is useful in the prototyping stage, right? If you're making prototypes in the design phase, and you want to see, do you want four holes over here, or you want eight holes? If you want the hole of 2 millimeter diameter or 5 millimeter diameter, you can test for functional attributes. And so in the design stage, you can get through that very fast. And so that's one way to make use of something like that. Okay. Any other questions? Right. So it's useful as a design tool, for instance. You know, in some cases, you want only 50 components. Right. And if you can make them in about 8 hours each, by the end of 2 weeks, you can just give it to someone. And you can, of course, charge a premium because no one else is making these parts of that complexity by any other method. And so there's a niche. And so if you made it by some other method, such as casting, yes, you could get millions of parts at the end of the year. But if they are not the right characteristic, then you wasted it, right? So you check first to see if it's useful, and then you go ahead to the next scale. And so this is one way to be able to do that, okay? Another thing is if it's a polymer such as this, or if it's a wax that you can build it off, right? If polymer can be fused at low energy, wax particles can be fused at lower energy, right? So you create a wax master, and then you can pack it around with sand particles, melt out the wax, and do an investment casting. Okay. So that was solid additives. Now let us look at the second case where the additive is melt. We saw different examples, right? We saw a little bit of detail of injection molding, but some casting is very similar. Extrusion is another one. We'll see an example of roll forming. And we'll look at, finally, another variation of the selective laser sintering, where now you use melt processing to create prototypes. Okay? So we'll take some examples like that. Injection molding, we will look at a greater detail in the second half of the class today. But mainly, you have an injection molding machine. You feed pellets. The pellets are made by a number of techniques. What were some kinds of mixing techniques we looked at yesterday? What did you say? Okay, go ahead, start. One, you put some powder, you put some polymer, you melt it, right? And you put it in an equipment, and you create a mixed material, right? Do you remember what was one type of instrument we looked at? Batch or continuous, very good. So an example of a batch mixer. So yes, so the Sigma Blade Mixer, is that what you say? So that is one type of a method. Planetary mixer was another one. Okay. What about continuous mixing now? You keep putting material out and you keep getting material out. Extruder, very good. Right? Single screw or two screws, both are possible. Right? So you make the pellet in that manner, and now you feed that into the hopper. You have this injection molding screw, right? It can move back and forth, and it can also rotate. Okay, so it's called a screw. So the motor over here will either rotate the screw, and it can also push it back and forth. If the screw rotates, obviously the material that gets fed will slowly get around to the front. Okay. There are heated zones that now begin to melt the pellets again. Okay. Now, finally, when the material reaches a molten stage and accumulates over here, the screw can now, instead of rotating, it can push like a plunger, right? You take a syringe and you push the liquid out through a hole, right? So you can push the material through and force it into a mold cavity. The second part of the machine can either open or close a mold. So there are two parts. There's a clamping unit, clamp, right? You close something and you open something. Close something, open something. Hold it under some pressure, right? To make sure that the mold does not open up when something is pushed into it. This part is called the hydraulic screw drive, which can push the material back and forth. So when the material accumulates here, it's pushed into the mold cavity. It fills the mold cavity. The part begins to cool. You open the mold cavity. You take the part out. Right? That is injection molding. Right? We'll look at it in a little bit more detail, but you have the mold, you have the clamping unit, and you have the injection unit. There are a couple of ways. The mold cavity over there typically has a few microns that is cut out as a vent, and as a material. So it's a good question, right? You have a mold, it's closed, there's still air in it. Now as material comes out, the air can be compressed up till a point, but if it's a full seal, it's going to remain as an air bubble, right, on the surface. So there are thin gaps cut between the surface of the mold. It is wide enough for air to pass out, but it is too narrow for material to push through. Okay, and then you can be able to push the air out. That's a good. Any other questions? Tell it in Portuguese. Someone will. Advantage. Oh, advantage. Okay. The main. Okay. Good. Thanks. The advantage is, it is a semi-continuous process. You keep putting the material, you keep putting the mixture here, you keep removing parts out here, because it can be fully automated. So you keep filling in the hopper over here. The machine can be programmed such that the molds will close, the material will get pushed through. Once it's solidified, the molds will open. There will be something that pushes a part out. And so it can go on without someone standing by the machine. Okay. The other thing is, this is one mold cavity. You could have, depending upon the size of the parts, in the case of the dental brackets, you can have about 128 mold cavities that can be filled in simultaneously. And it is basically suitable for a high level of automation. And that makes manufacturing costs lower. It increases manufacturing throughput to a great extent. And those are huge advantages compared to a lot of other processes. Imagine that instead, for instance, just as a one limiting case scenario, right? You had to machine one part at a time. It would take a lot longer to machine one part at a time compared to filling the mold cavity frequently. Hundreds of mold cavities at the same time, right? So the volume of manufacturing goes higher. Correspondingly, the cost of manufacturing comes down. And any scrap that is generated can be, right? So if there are some defective parts or there are regions of the mold, we'll see that part, right? They can be ground up and fed back in over here. So the material usage can be very high. The combination of saving on materials, increasing throughput, saving on labor, and saving on energy all allow for some environmental and cost benefits.